So in my presentation, I'm going to share with you the methodology to monitor the drug efficacy that we use in our project in Cambodia, the malaria project. So it's a second presentation on Cambodia. I make the presentation on behalf also of the colleagues that are listed on the screen. Now, first, a few words on the project. So the overall objective of the project is to develop strategies to eliminate the Plasmodium falciparum from that area of artemisinin resistance. And so you know artemisinin is the most potent drug we have against malaria, definitely an indispensable drug. And so the reason why we are working on malaria in Cambodia is specifically to tackle that resistance. Now, it's obvious, it's common sense that the last resisting parasites and the last strains are going to be the most resistant ones, which means that if we want to tackle resistance, ultimately we will have to work towards elimination in such an area. So the reason that we are there is, of course, to avoid the spread of the resistance from that area to other areas. So on the map, you see the place where we are working, so the district Chesan bordering Thailand, and you see the study period. We started in October 2015, and I have data until April 2018. So within that broad objective of the project, we have a number of specific issues, questions linked to the efficacy, or the resistance, if you want. So the first one is more on the public health level. We want to make sure that if there would be a decrease in the efficacy of the ACTs, so the artemisinin-based combination therapy that we are using, that we would be able to detect this in an early stage. We need this to know, obviously, because if this would be the case, we will have to change the drugs or eventually the drug regimen. Or if it would not be black-white, this can be then an indication to do a full-scale, full-blown efficacy study, which is very heavy, because this means you have to do PCR, we have to do microscopy, and for a single patient, we need at least 10 samples, day one, day two, day three, and so on, up till day 42, so which is heavy for the patient and quite resource intensive. And then on the individual level, we want also to detect in an early stage if someone is not responding well to a treatment, because if someone is not responding, very likely to be resistant, a resistant parasite, we don't want that this person continues to contribute to further transmission. Now, what we do concretely in the project is we do, of course, case finding, which means we test and treat patients with fever. We do reactive case finding, which means that if we have a positive malaria case, we consider it as an index case and we test around, that's the household and people working in the similar places where probably the transmission is ongoing. And we do proactive case finding, which means we do send MSF staff to the villages where they test people on a regular basis, people that have risk exposure, concretely working in the forest. We also have basic vector control, and so we do the monitoring of resistance in vitro, I come back to that. So, in fact, where does the question come from now? We have in the project a strengthened case management, which is, of course, not the routine way of working that we have in Congo or in Africa, but we have a strengthened case management system, not for research purposes, but simply we want to make sure that in that area with resistance, a patient is treated and the parasites are indeed eliminated. And so the question that came up was, can we not, if we use now that opportunity of a strengthened case management, if we would now structure and standardize the follow-up, could we not use this and evaluate this as a methodology, a lighter methodology, to monitor the drug efficacy or the resistance, if you want? So let me first explain now what it means, that strengthened monitoring of the patients as we do it. So if we have a case, usually rapid diagnostic test, we do systematically take at day zero a dry blood spot that is analyzed in the central lab in Phnom Penh, the Pasteur Institute lab. So the dry blood spot that we take, and then we give all the patients a 3 days directly observed treatment, because we cannot in such a situation work with incomplete treatments or accept incomplete treatments, of course. And you see that we have been using two different ACTs in the first period, the hydroartemisinin piperaquine, and because of the resistance, we had to switch later on to artesunate mefloquine. Then for the follow-up of the patients, we go back, we trace back the patients, all the patients at day 28, and we take again a dry blood spot. We get the result normally within a week, and so we want to make sure that indeed the patient has eliminated all the parasites. Then specifically in the frame of a study, we added also day 63, I will come back to that, but this was to validate if day 28 was indeed a good time and a good indicator for us to base our methodology on. And then there's the further monitoring that takes place mainly in the laboratory of Pasteur, where they follow up on our in vivo samples, and that stands for the treatment failures, the distinction between reinfection, recrudescence. They also calculate the estimated parasitemia based on the PCR, as we don't have microscopy, and they follow the different molecular markers that are correlating with resistance. And so that's the ones correlating with artemisinin resistance, mefloquine, and piperaquine resistance. Now, the three specific questions to which I will come back one by one is, first of all, we want to know, are our ACTs still efficacious? Is day 28 a good choice? And if we make such an analysis, should we include all the patients? Now, for the first question, are the ACTs that we have been using, are they still efficacious enough? And so what we did here, what you see, is the PCR-based parasitological treatment failure on day 28. So if we look at the first row, and maybe just look at the percentage, and you have the confidence interval as well, so we see that when we were still using DHA piperaquine, we had 36% treatment failures, and even more concerning, we saw that the vast majority were recrudescences, so meaning the parasites were not eliminated by the drug. Because of that resistance, we had to switch to an alternative drug, which is still today artesunate mefloquine. And you see that, the second row, there we only have 7% treatment failures. And moreover, there is not a single recrudescence among these patients. It's all reinfections. I just have to mention that, unfortunately, we had quite some samples with insufficient genetic material to do the analysis, so it's based on relatively small numbers. So this, first of all, gave us the very clear conclusion: the use of dehydroartemisinin piperaquine is definitely no longer justified in that area. The second question is day 28 an acceptable time to do that evaluation? The question comes from the fact that normally, in a standard efficacy study, we always do day 42. But we are using PCR, which means we're using a more sensitive technique. And moreover, we want to make sure that the patient not responding to treatment is identified quite early. And so you see that for that reason, we did day 63. And so here you see, and we only did it in the artesunate mefloquine period, you see that from the 261 patients from whom we had day 28 negative, that only 7% had day 63 positivity rate. And moreover, there was not a single case of recrudescence, which for us led to the conclusion day 28 is indeed a good time to do it. It's not too early to base our conclusions on. The third question of the methodology was then, should we include all patients? And this question comes from the fact that in the standard efficacy studies, normally we exclude all the patients with a parasitemia below 1,000 parasites per microliter. The reason is simply that if you start very low, and if you take your drug, that even in case of resistance, you may not yet have sufficient parasites to be detectable during the follow-up period. So on this slide, you see the same data on the left that I showed you already. And we did the exercise over again, excluding the samples where we had the parasitemia load below 1,000 parasites. And you see indeed, looking again at the percentage, that while in the initial one we had 36% treatment failures, this becomes 59% treatment failures in the first row, so with our DHA piperaquine, with touching confidence intervals, showing that indeed, if we include the low parasitemic ones, that we may underestimate the resistance or overestimate the efficacy, as it's written on the slide. So the conclusions for us is that, first of all, the implementation is feasible. It's of course not the routine data that we have in our African projects, but in such a place where we want anyhow the patient to get 3 days directly observed treatment, and we want anyhow to make sure that we have a follow-up after 28 days, and we see that we managed to trace back at least 60% of the patients for that follow-up on day 28. So it's feasible. And so we see that the PCR-based day 28 treatment is indeed an appropriate indicator. It's not too early. And we see that if we would include all the patients, including the low parasitemic ones, that we may overestimate the treatment efficacy. So it does make sense to exclude these patients from the analysis. Now, how have we been using these results, or what was the relevance? First of all, as we could document that high failure rate of DHAP paraquine, this clearly was a reason to say that we should change also in the area where we were working as a priority the ACT to the alternative one, which was in this case the artesunate mefloquine. And then, as there were similar results from other areas, this led at the end to the nationwide decision to drop the first line DHAP paraquine and change it everywhere to artesunate mefloquine. And so we realized, of course, even if I did put in the title routine data, this is not, again, the routine for our African setting, but we think that this methodology of using what we have can be relevant in places where we do have, first of all, few cases, which means pre-elimination or elimination setting, so where we can afford a close monitoring of the individual patient, and especially where we are confronted with a high level of resistance, because that's the places where we cannot wait until these full-scale efficacy studies are done, which sometimes takes 2-3 years before we have the results, but just to make sure that we have nearly real-time, at least basic information about the efficacy of the drugs that we are using, and that we do this on top of the in vitro monitoring based on the molecular markers. So I would like to thank our study partners, so that's the Pasteur Institute in Phnom Penh and the National Malaria Control Program, CNM, and also our MSF Cambodian staff, because they are doing the main work in the fields, and the population of that district where we have been working for several years now, Che San, the representatives of that population, and you for your attention. Thank you.